Hello everyone. Last time we have explained about the first type of fisheries, that is inland fisheries, which includes the freshwater resources such as small and large rivers of the India, including their small riverets or the tributaries. Then secondly, the different type of freshwater resources in the form of ponds, lakes, dams, etc., together with the small and large freshwater resources which can be exploited or used for the fishery purpose. So, last time we have completed about the inland fisheries including different type of freshwater resources such as rivers, ponds, lakes, dams, etc., and we have explained the two type of inland fisheries, that is one riverine system or river system, and secondly the pond culture. Now today we are going to explain the second type of fisheries, that is marine fisheries. And marine fisheries includes the sea water habitat. So India is having the best ideal conditions to establish the marine fisheries, because the India is bordered with seas and oceans on three sides. So India is having much longer sea coast, and thus which could be exploited for the fishery purpose, and where the different regions of the sea coast which has been bordered with India having a large or a tremendous quantity of fish wealth or the animal wealth, and thus there is a much scope or tremendous scope or the potential for the fishery production in India. So marine fisheries thus can be divided into three types, that is coastal or inshore fisheries, then offshore fisheries, and thirdly the deep sea fisheries. So with the consideration of the depth, with the consideration of the depth of the sea from coastal region to the interior of the sea or ocean can be exploited for the fishery purpose, and thus marine fisheries can be divided into coastal fisheries, offshore fisheries, and the deep sea fisheries. So since the India is bordered with the seas, that is Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal, or that is east coast or west coast or south east coast or northeast coast. So there are three sides of the India, and which is covered with the seas, that is Arabian Sea and the Bay of Bengal, and thus there is much of the potential, or there is much of the scope for the establishment of the marine fisheries so as to increase the fishery production of the India. So marine fisheries having the ideal conditions for the India, and there is much of the scope for the establishment of the marine fisheries, and this includes three type of fisheries, that is coastal, offshore, and the deep sea fisheries. So we'll explain the marine fisheries with respect to its three types one by one. So first we'll explain coastal fisheries. Marine fishery resources of a country depend on a number of factors. Marine fishery resources of a country depend on number of factors. The oceanographical features, the oceanographical features of the seas have a direct bearing or effect on the fish fauna and nature of the fisheries. The chemical nature of the water, salt contents of the water, or nutrients in a water are intimately related with the production of the plankton, that is zooplankton or the phytoplankton, which forms the food for the fishes. The currents, that is the wave currents of the sea, then winds, and the upwelling of the oceans exercise a great influence on the movement of the fishes and their young ones. Besides, the land beneath or the bottom of the sea and the continental shelf or its area and the slope are also some extent to determines the facilities of the fishing. So these are the some of the different features or the characteristics of the sea or the oceans or the marine resources of the India. So marine fishery resources of the country depending on the number of factors, and these are the mainly oceanographical features of the seas which are having direct bearing or the effect on the fish fauna and the nature of the fisheries, means small or large scale fisheries or the production of the fishes from the respective regions. That is the nature of fisheries, may be less or more depending upon presence of fish fauna available in the particular regions. The chemical nature of the water, then salt contents, then nutrients are intimately related with the production of the plankton which forms the food for the fishes. The currents, that is the wave currents of the sea, then winds and the upwelling of the ocean exercise a great influence of the movements of the fishes and their young ones. Besides, the land beneath the seas and the continental shelf, then its area and the slope are also to some extent determines the facilities of the fishing. The two seas, that is the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea, are radically different from each other with consideration of the oceanographical features or the certain other parameters, maybe chemical, physico-chemical parameters of the water or the weather conditions of the coastal regions. There are differences found among the two seas, that is the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea. So the two seas which are present around India, that is are in the form of Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea, are radically different from each other. The eastern or Coromandel coast has a narrow continental shelf and which declines sharply. Eastern or the east coast or Coromandel coast of sea has a narrow continental shelf and which declines, having slope, declines sharply to the offshore and deep sea waters. The circulation of the water on this coast is less pronounced. The circulation of the water on the east coast or the Coromandel coast is less pronounced than northeast monsoon winds which sweep over the Bay of Bengal are moderate and are of shorter duration. The deltas of the large rivers flowing into the bay and the several coastal lakes provide estuaries with their own characteristic fishery resources. In the Andhra zone, that is also from east coast, in the Andhra zone a certain degree of upwelling has been observed. Then plankton production is comparatively poor in the Bay of Bengal. The influence of these physical, chemical and biological factors is reflected on the quantity of the fish available as well as the different varieties of the fishes. Means with the consideration of the physical, chemical or the biological factors and certain other oceanographical features and the weather conditions of the east coast are comparatively poor, and thus the fish fauna available is comparatively less along the east coast of India than the west coast. The west or Malabar coast on the other hand has higher fish production. Continental shelf is broader. The southwest monsoon is stronger and longer. The upwelling of waters also more pronounced and brings about a better circulation in the sea. The seasonal cycles of the waters of the Arabian Sea are more abundant, leading to the higher plankton production, and the effect of these factors is a richer fish both in a variety or rich number of species and the quantity in the west coast. It is estimated that more than 75% of the total fish landing or the catch of the India are from the west coast. So as we have explained, the marine resource of the India, that is the sea or estuaries or the sea coast, which has covered the three sides of the India, that is east coast, southeast or southwest, then northeast, and also the west coast of the India, having different features with respect to oceanographic feature, physical, chemical or biological factors, together with the weather conditions, that is wave currents, then wind currents, then upwelling of the sea, then continental shelf. So all these factors are affecting the availability of the fish fauna in the particular region. So with the consideration of the various properties, that is oceanographical features, then weather conditions, then physical, chemical or biological factors of the east coast and west coast, the comparatively the situation is very much better or good as far as the marine fishery is concerned. The west coast is having the better features, that is oceanographic features, then weather conditions, and also the physical, chemical or biological factors with respect to availability of the planktons or the food for the fishes, or the availability of the fish species, that is adults or young ones, is also much more in a sea or along the west coast than the east coast. So about 75% of the fish landing or the total catch of the India is from the west coast. So for the convenience of fishery statistics, the extensive coast of India is divided into 12 zones or the regions as follows. For convenience of the fishery statistics, the extensive coast of India is divided into 12 zones as follows. The first one, that is West Bengal and Orissa. Second, Andhra coast. So Andhra coast is divisible into three zones. Andhra region or the Andhra coast is divided into three regions or three zones, such as south of Gopalpur to the north of Vishakhapatnam, then Vishakhapatnam to Masulipatnam, and south of Masulipatnam to the north Pulikat. So the first zone, that is West Bengal and Orissa. Then second is Andhra coast, south of Gopalpur to the north of Vishakhapatnam. Third is Andhra coast, Vishakhapatnam to Masulipatnam. Fourth zone is Andhra coast, south of Masulipatnam to the north Pulikat. Then fifth zone, Coromandel coast, extending from Pulikat lake to the Kadalore. And sixth zone of the Coromandel coast, from south of Kadalore to the Devipatnam. Then seventh zone, that is Pak Bay and Gulf of Mannar. Then eighth zone, that is Kerala and South Malabar. Kerala and South Malabar, which includes Cape Tamarind to the Ponani River. Then Malabar and South Kapra, that is from extending from North Ponani River to the Mangalore. Then 10th zone, that is Konkan coast, from North Mangalore to the South Ratnagiri. Then 11th zone, that is Maharashtra and Gujarat coast, that is Ratnagiri to Bharuch. And 12th zone, that is Kathiawar coast. So these are the 12 zones of the sea coast, extending from northeast to east, then east to southeast, then northwest, then west coast, and again the northwest coast. So the entire coast of India from three sides, which has bordered with the three sides of India, And for the convenience of the fishery statistics, the extensive coast of India has been divided into 12 zones, and these are as per the list which already we have read, the 12 zones of the sea coast of the India, and which can be thus exploited by the various states or the peoples from various states for the purpose of fishery practice or fishery production. So this is about the coastal fisheries. So 12 zones of the sea coast which can be exploited for the inshore fishery or the coastal fishery. Then second type is offshore fisheries, and third one will be deep sea fisheries. Now we will explain the offshore fisheries. Beyond the area of the continental shelf, that is just interior or just inside to the sea coast, will begin the offshore region. So beyond the area of the continental shelf is the expansive ocean, rich in various kind of fishes. Some of them are surface dweller, some are mid water dwellers, and while others live in a deeper waters or at the bottom of the sea. The exploitation of these fish fauna or the use of this fish fauna constitutes the offshore and the deep sea fisheries. These were not given much attention in owing to a lack of mechanized or power boats and enterprising businessmen. Besides, the economic conditions of the fishermen didn't permit large capital necessary for the power fishing. So, beyond the area of the continental shelf or just inside or just interior to the coastal area begins the offshore, and after which there will be a deep sea regions of the seas or the oceans, and which can be thus exploited for the purpose of harvesting of the large quantity of the fishes from the respective regions. But this requires the advanced type of equipments for the catching and transporting, or even provision of the refrigeration facility are also of great importance for the fishery production. So we'll explain now the offshore or deep sea fisheries one by one. So offshore fisheries, beyond the area of the continental shelf is the expansive ocean, which is rich in various type of fishes, and some of them are surface dweller, some are mid water dwellers, and others live in the deeper region or the waters or the bottom of the sea. The exploitation of these fish fauna, the exploitation or the use of these fish fauna for the fishery purpose constitutes offshore and the deep sea fisheries. These were not given much attention in owing to lack of mechanized or power boats and the enterprising businessmen. So the exploitation of these fish fauna or the offshore regions are of not much popularized or not well developed fishery practice found among different regions of the India, and this is because of lack of mechanized or power boats and the enterprising businessmen, because the economic conditions of the fishermen didn't permit a large capital necessary for the power fishing. Around the turn of the century, means at the end of 20th century, however, attempts were made to survey the offshore fish fauna. Preliminary trawlers survey were done in the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea of the Mumbai and Kathiawar coast, as well as some parts of the Konkan and the Coromandel coast. And these surveys revealed the existence of great wealth of the fishes and located in a various centers of a rich harvest for the future exploitation. It was not until after World War II that further attempts were made in that direction. In 1946, the government of India established pilot deep sea fishery station at Mumbai. and several state governments like Kerala and West Bengal also set up their own marine fisheries stations in subsequent years, so as to establish or so as to popularize or so as to improve the fishery practice or the so as to increase the fishery production in the respective regions of the states. By 1958, the central government added two more centers, the fishery centers, at one at Cochin and the other at the Visakhapatnam. The scientific and technical aspects of the work are being conducted in a collaboration with various foreign experts from countries like Norway, Japan and United States. There are at present five important trawling grounds and they are located at Mumbai, Cambay, Verawal, Porbandar and the Dwarka, where through these five centers the offshore and deep sea fishery practice became popular and have been increased the fishery production of the marine fisheries. The most important commercial offshore fishes are Ravas or Indian salmon, Elithronia tetrodactylus, then Dara including giant headfin, Polydactylus indices, then Ghol, that is a jewfish, Pseudocina dicanthus, then Koth, that is Otolithrais, Brunius, a large cynide, Worm, that is a sea eel, Ophranomosaurus, then Carcara, Grunters and jewfishes and pomprates. In addition, the catfishes, rays and the small selenids are also found among the catches. So these are the some of the important species of the fishes which can be obtained or harvested from the offshore fisheries. The most profitable depth is about 20 fathoms, that is 37 meter deep in the offshore regions, and the catches are more better during the daytime than the night and also during neap tide than the spring tides. Trawlers are used for large scale fishing in the offshore and deep sea zones. Various kinds of trawling nets are in use, the oldest being the otter type. The Japanese method of bull trawling has been found to be more effective and is extensively used in Mumbai and Saurashtra waters. The other two experimental centers of trawling are at Kerala and Bengal. In Kerala, method known as dory fishing is in use, and in this a mother ship tows out small boats to the offshore fishing grounds. Dory fishing is common in Kerala. In this dory fishing, a mother ship tows out the small boats to the offshore fishing grounds, and the actual fishing is done by use of hooks and the lines, and these explorations have indicated the existence of profitable perch fishery grounds in the Arabian Sea. So this is what the information regarding the offshore fishery, and offshore fishery is thus most profitable up to the depth of 20 fathoms, that is 37 meter deep, and the catches are more better during the daytime than the night, or also during neap tide than the spring tide. Trawlers are used for large scale fishing in the offshore and the deep sea zones for the harvesting of the fish. Then various kind of trawling nets are in use, the oldest being the otter type. The Japanese method called bull trawling has been found to be more effective and extensively used in the Mumbai and Saurashtra waters for the offshore fishery practice. The other two experimental centers of the trawling are present in Kerala and Bengal. In Kerala, method known as dory fishing is used. In this, a mother ship tows out a small boats to the offshore fishing grounds, and the actual fishing is done by the use of hooks and the lines. and these explorations have indicated the existence of profitable perch fishery. These explorations have indicated the existence or profitable perch fishery grounds in the Arabian Seas. Then deep sea fisheries. The most important fishes of the deep sea and offshore areas are various species of perches. The most important fishes of the deep sea and offshore areas are various species of perches like Epinephilus and Luteanus among the teleost, and Carcharinus and Pristis among the shark. The deep sea fishing stations in the Bay of Bengal are located at Black Pagoda. The deep sea fishing stations in the Bay of Bengal are located at Black Pagoda, Sandhead, Tiger Point, False Bay Point, off the Devi River mouth, off the Prachi River mouth, and off the Baitarni River mouth. So these are the various regions which are exploited for the fishery purpose with respect to the deep sea regions. The common catches are cyanids, perches, ribbon pieces, eels, and sharks and the rays. So these are the common catches or the fishes obtained from or caught or harvested from the deep sea regions of the India. Deep sea fishery to be successful should have harbor and anchorage facilities. So the deep sea fisheries, so as to have the successful fishery practice or the fishery production from the deep sea fisheries or the deep sea regions, should have the harbor and the anchorage facilities, motor transport from landing places to the center of distribution and the consumption. Motor transport facilities from landing places to the centers of the distribution and the consumption. Then marketing and storage facilities. Marketing and storage facilities. Besides, scientifically trained men or the people, and these requirements are under study by the various state governments. These requirements are under study by the various state governments and the union government, with the collaboration of experts and technical aid of the countries where fisheries have advanced on scientific lines. Thus, it will be possible to establish deep sea fisheries on modern lines in India. So, with the consideration of the power fishing, then motor boats, with the consideration of the power boat, then motor boats, power fishing, motor boats, then refrigeration facilities or the transport facility should be developed or established, so that the fishery production and from the marine fisheries, that is coastal fishery, offshore fisheries or the deep sea fishery, is can be developed or can be established if the all fishery practices or the all activities should be managed properly or scientifically, then only it is possible to increase or the harvest the fish wealth from the marine resources such as coastal, offshore or the deep sea regions. So there is much of the scope or the tremendous scope or the potential of the marine fisheries, but that could be harvested or that could be done for the successful practice of the fishery, that is catching, harvesting, transporting, preservation. So there are several factors which should be managed with the adequate level or optimum level, so that the fishery production could be increased manifold in the regions, that is coastal or offshore or the deep sea fishery regions of the India. So there is much of the potential for the fishery production. There is a much of the potential or much of the scope for the production or increasing the fishery production with respect to the marine resources. Then third type of the fisheries, that is estuarine fisheries. Estuarine fisheries are the brackish water fisheries. So till now we have explained about the inland fisheries, where we have explained about the riverine and the pond water fisheries. Then secondly, the marine fisheries, which has been divided into three types, that is coastal fishery, offshore fisheries, or the deep shore fisheries, where there is much of the scope yet to develop or to increase the fishery production. And third type of fisheries is the estuarine fisheries or the brackish water fisheries. So estuarine fisheries are located in the mouths of the rivers, that is Ganges, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri on the east coast, and the Narmada and the Tapi on the west coast. So estuarine fisheries includes the mouth or deltas of the rivers and the seas of the Ganga, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri on the west coast, because these rivers flows from west to the east. So their deltas or the estuaries are present at the east coast of the India, and including the river mouth or the estuarine regions of the Ganga, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri on the east coast, and the Narmada and Tapi on the west coast, because these flows from east to the west. Narmada and Tapi river, they flows from the east eastern region to the west coast. So estuarine fisheries are located in the mouth of the rivers of the Ganga, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri on the east coast, and the Narmada and the Tapi on the west coast. In addition, lakes like Chilka and Pulikat and the backwaters of the Travancore coast in Kerala are well known. Estuaries and estuarine lakes have saline waters. Only those fishes which can withstand or adapt changes in salty conditions thrive best or survive best in the estuarine lakes or the estuarine regions. Some species of the sardines and anchovies, such as Hilsa hilsa, Anchovilla, Thrissocles, Nematolosa, and Cetipinna, then mullets such as Liza corsula, Mugil cephalus, catfishes, that is Tachysaurus, Arius pangasius, Mistus, and perches such as Latus caliper, then Epinephilus, then pearl spots, Eutroplus are the most common. So these are the some of the important species of the fishes which are found in the estuarine habitat or the brackish water habitats, including different type of estuaries or the river mouths along the east and west coast, and together with the certain estuarine ponds or the lakes which can also be exploited or used for the estuarine fisheries. The Chilka Lake of Orissa needs a special mention. The Chilka Lake of the Orissa needs special mention, or it is one of the largest of estuarine lake in India, with an area of 906 square kilometer in the dry summer. In the rainy season, it swells up and its volume increases up to 1,165 square kilometer. A channel of 23 kilometer connects it with the Bay of Bengal, and it receives most of its water from the Daya, one of the deltaic branch of the Mahanadi. The important marine fishes are gairs, ambassis, then strangura, genetodon, therapon, selagodogs, wild carps like catfishes and morels constitute the freshwater varieties in the Chilka Lake of the Orissa. So the Chilka Lake of the Orissa is found to be the largest estuarine lake of the India and can be exploited for the estuarine fisheries, which is having area of about 906 square kilometer in a dry summer, and in rainy season it grows or expands or swells up to 1165 square kilometer, and with a channel of 23 kilometer connecting it with the Bay of Bengal. And then it also receives the most of its water from the Daya, that is one of the deltaic branch of the Mahanadi. And the important marine fishes found among the Chilka Lake: gears, ambassis, strangura, genentodon, therapon, selago dogs, wild carps, then catfishes and the murrells constitutes the freshwater varieties in the Chilka Lake. The annual production is around 3000 metric tons. The annual production of the fish from the Chilka Lake is around 3000 metric tons, of which 90% are exported in a fresh condition and the remaining is consumed locally or salted dried. So this is what the example of the estuarine fisheries or the brackish water fisheries, which has been exploited properly for the fishery production, and the results are: the annual production is in the form of 3000 metric tons, and out of which 90% are exported in a fresh condition and remaining is consumed locally or salted dried. Another type of estuarine lakes are the embanked brackish water. Another type of estuarine lakes is the embanked brackish water and are protected by artificial walls or the barriers. In India, it is practiced in West Bengal, where it is called as Basbanda fisheries, or bears in the estuary lands are reclaimed by building walls or bunds to keep away the floods of the tidal water. So another type of estuarine lake or the example of the estuarine fishery is the embanking of the brackish waters and are protected by the artificial walls or the barriers, which has been developed or practiced in West Bengal, and it is called as Basbanda fisheries or bears. In the estuary, lands are reclaimed. The lands of the estuarine region are reclaimed, that is, by building the walls or bunds to keep away the flood water or the tidal waters of the sea of the West Bengal. Such reclaimed lands or the estuarine lakes are used for the agricultural purposes, for raising of a crop for a certain period, and when the land is not under cultivation, it is used for growing fishes, for which purpose the shallows are filled with fresh water. So such reclaimed lands or the estuarine ponds can be used for two purposes. One, that is agricultural purpose, for raising a crop like paddy cultivation, and secondly, when the land is not under cultivation of the paddy crop, it is used for growing fishes, and for which purpose the shallows or estuarine lakes are filled with the fresh water, and which is let in through the sluice gates from the rivers. And this supply of water brings with it a fish. This supply of water, that is riverine water or the river water, can also be used for the filling of the estuarine ponds and can be used for the fishery purpose. So the supply of water brings with it fish and their fry, which grow up in these confined or protected estuarine lakes or the ponds. When they reach a good size, or they are caught for the market. So such reclaimed lands or the estuarine ponds can be used for the cultivation of paddy, or side by side can also be used for the fishery purpose, together with the fresh water from the river rivers can also be used for the filling of these shallow ponds, which are actually the estuarine ponds, but can also be filled up with the fresh waters of the river. And whatever the fish fauna, that is the fries or the different fish species which flows along with the river currents into the these shallow ponds or the protected ponds, and where these are grown for the certain period, and when they acquire or grows to a good size or marketable size, they are caught and sold in the market. Malabar is also the famous for its embanked brackish water fisheries. Malabar coast, that is a west coast. Malabar is also the famous for its embanked brackish water fisheries. The areas near backwaters of the Kerala, then Vempadal Kayal, Vempanad Kayal have been reclaimed for the paddy cultivation, and there is only a single annual paddy crop from July to September. After the harvest, the bunds or walls are raised and strengthened, and at a high tide, the sea water is let in. So, another example of the estuarine fishery, that is Malabar, is also famous for its embanked brackish water lake or the brackish water fisheries. The area near the backwaters of the Kerala, that is Vempanad Kayal, have been reclaimed or prepared as the estuarine pond or the lake for paddy cultivation. And there is only a single annual paddy crop from July to September. So, after the harvest of the paddy crop, the bunds or walls are raised and strengthened properly, and they are filled up with a sea water at a high tide. They are filled up with a sea water during the high tide. So, at high tide, the sea water is let in or allowed to fill up these ponds or the estuarine lakes, and fishes and prawns in thousands are brought into these confined areas or the shallow ponds, which are artificially prepared for the fishery purpose or paddy cultivation also. But paddy crop is taken only once in a year, so remaining time or the season then can be used for the fishery purpose. So, water from sea at high tide will be allowed to fill up these ponds, and large quantity of fishes and the prawns can brought into the shallow ponds or the confined waters or the estuarine lakes, where they grow for about 6 months. And when they are ready for capture, the mullets and pearl spots are most abundant among fishes and contribute about 20%, while prawns make up the balance. Means in a Kerala, the estuarine fishery in the Malabar region, where embanking brackish water lakes are prepared, and the backwaters of the Kerala, that is the Vempanad Kayal, has been reclaimed and used for the paddy cultivation for only one season, that is July to September, and after harvesting of the paddy, the bunds and walls are strengthened, and during the high tide they are filled up with the sea water, and with the sea water currents, the large quantity of the fish and prawns in thousands are brought into these shallow ponds, where they grow for about 6 months, and after which they become ready for capture. The mullets and the pearl spots are most common fish species, and the contributes about 20%, while prawns make up the balance. Means prawns are also obtained in a considerable quantity. Then Narakal farm has become important in a fish rearing in India. Narakal in Kerala, originally a swamp. Narakal farm is also another example of the estuarine fishery. Narakal farm is another important example of the estuarine fishery, and it is present in Kerala. Narakkal in Kerala, originally a swamp, and it was taken over by the government, CIFRS, and converted into a useful farm for the mullets or the mugils and the milk fish, that is chanos. The farm consists of several ponds. The Narakkal farm consists of several ponds with bunds and the sluice gates with the area of 50 square kilometer, and the fishes are let in along with the tide. Mugil cephalus is a prominent species and contributes about 75%. It is a fast growing fish which grows 45 cm in a year, and similar farm has been set up in a South Kerala at Airani Thengu. The farm is about 0.08 square kilometer in size and is utilized for uteroplus cultivation or fishery. The most useful fishes for brackish water cultivation are chanos, mugil, uteroplus, tilapia and Aspranomys or gourami. So, most useful fishes for the brackish water cultivation are chanos, mugil, uteroplus, tilapia and Aspranomys or commonly called as gourami. So, these are the some of the important species which can be grown in the estuarine fisheries or the estuarine ponds or the lakes, which are the artificial estuarine ponds and can be exploited for the fishery purpose. So, this is what about the marine fisheries and the estuarine fisheries. So, we have completed all the three type of fisheries of the India, that is inland fisheries including the river system and the ponds and the lakes, which are the freshwater resources and can be exploited for the fishery purpose, that is riverine fisheries and the pond culture or the pisciculture. Then secondly, the marine fisheries includes the coastal fisheries, offshore fisheries and the deep shore fisheries, and the third type of fishery, that is the estuarine fisheries or the brackish water fisheries. So, this is what all about the three types of the fisheries, such as inland fisheries, marine fisheries and the estuarine fisheries. So, next time we will continue with the second topic. So, with this we will stop here. Thank you.